In the news this week, a committee calls for compulsory sex education in primary schools. The Home Secretary says Christian unions won't be restricted by anti-terror plans, and a letter defending free speech prompts online attacks. Hello and welcome to this week's News Bulletin from the Christian Institute. All state primary and secondary schools should be teaching sex education, a committee of MPs has said in a new report. The Education Select Committee says that teaching about sex and relationships should be a core part of PSHE. One of the report's recommendations is that Ofsted inspectors should measure the quality of PSHE and sex and relationships education in schools. Pro-family groups stress the role of parents in handling the sensitive issue of sex education. The Christian Institute's Deputy Director for Public Affairs, Simon Calvert, told BBC Radio London why the MP's solution was wrong.
The biggest problem with this is it's a one-size-fits-all approach. It's a typical sort of response of, you know, politicians who want to be seen to be doing something about what is a recognised problem. So they come up with, you know, a wizzo solution, but actually it isn't a solution. You know, you don't prevent the early sexualisation of children by requiring their teachers to teach them about sex. It's the wrong solution to the problem.
The government has so far resisted calls to introduce statutory sex education for primary schools. It said it would carefully consider the findings of the new report. The government has given an assurance that Christian unions will not be impeded by new anti-terror plans. The plans, which are contained in the Counter-Terrorism and Security Bill and related guidance, have prompted widespread concerns about free speech. Speaking in the House of Commons, Home Secretary Theresa May responded to a Conservative MP's question on the issue.
I'm grateful to the Home Secretary. Could she assure me that when she considers the responses to the consultation, the final document will be so cast that it does not, albeit inadvertently, impede the work of genuine and benign, well-intentioned student bodies such as Christian unions and other groups that are active within our universities?
I can give my honourable friend that assurance. There is absolutely no intention that it should have any impact on the sort of benign organisations that he is referring to.
The Christian Institute welcomed the Home Secretary's comments, but said the issue was not over yet. CI supporters prayed about this issue, responded to the consultation on the guidance, and contacted their MPs, and now we are seeing a positive response from the government. We will continue to watch developments and analyse the final guidance to see that the government follows through and that our concerns are properly addressed. A letter calling for more free speech in universities has sparked online attacks from transsexual rights activists. The letter to The Observer criticised institutions for banning speakers whose views are deemed to be transphobic. It was signed by 130 people, including academics, gay rights campaigner Peter Tatchell, and transsexuals. But since the letter was published, Tatchell has received over 5,000 messages attacking his stance, including some that were threatening. He described the volume and vitriol of the attack as almost unprecedented in his time as a campaigner. Cambridge University professor Mary Beard said she went to bed wanting to weep after being bombarded with hundreds of hateful tweets. Cumulative harassment is what it felt like. What it would stand by forever would be the centrality of free debate in universities and elsewhere. A bid to explicitly outlaw sex-selective abortion is expected to be voted on in the House of Commons on Monday, the 23rd of February. MPs have previously backed Fiona Bruce on the issue, but her amendment to the Serious Crime Bill would explicitly place the idea into law. In a letter outlining their concerns, representatives from the Muslim, Hindu and Sikh faiths joined Christians in speaking in support of the ban. "We believe the government can and should play a part. This amendment provides that opportunity. Our experience tells us that practical help is needed in areas where women are sometimes devalued and degraded to the extent that people try to stop them from being born." The letter sent to all MPs was signed by 25 groups, including the UK's Muslim Women's Network, Hindu Council and Sikh Council. Well, that's all for this week. For regular updates and information on all our stories, plus much more, visit our website at christian.org.uk. Until next time, goodbye.